of them. Fortunately, the fundamental relevance of the story of the, and the meaning of the Holocaust was another. As the year 2020 unfolded, we at Yad Vashem, together with our allies and friends around the globe, reveal once again that highlighting the relevance of the Shoah, while often difficult, can also be deeply rewarding. By leveraging the advanced technologies that were already at our disposal, and which we further developed and adapted, Yad Vashem and its partner were able to maintain and even widen our sphere of communication, learning, and influence. Literally millions of persons in dozens of countries, including the countries that you are representing today, choose to join in many hundreds of events and frameworks that we offered online. Classes, lectures, seminars, symposia, tour, exhibits, chat groups were formed and keep on working, online, already readily accessible. At any given moment, around the clock, around the world, hundreds, if not thousands of people are engaged in online Yad Vashem activities. The number continue to grow steadily. These activities have been created vibrant communities of remembrance that transcended borders and time zone, that transcended or even the distress of the pandemic in the cause of morality and tolerance. True, these communities and Yad Vashem, which inform and inspire them, face considerable obstacles. The world tensions and conflicts, including those reflecting anti-Semitism and other forms of extreme racism, seem to have grown in this past year. Democracy and human rights seem no stronger than before. Yet, central message of January 27th is to resist despair over the world situation and rather to work for its repair. The survivors of the Holocaust have taught us that even amidst of the darkest moment, there is reason for hope. We thank you for sharing that hope with us. We invite you, your governments and your civil societies, to join with us in translating the hope into effective action. No one should try to predict now under which circumstances we will gather next January 27. But I predict on behalf of Yad Vashem that it will be in a world that have gained greater insight into the constructive potential of remembering the Shoah. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Dorit. I am honored to invite His Excellency Ambassador Gil Haskel, Chief of Protocol at the Israeli Ministry of Foreign Affairs, to deliver his remarks.
Thank you very much. Your Excellency, President Ruvi Rivlin, Director General of Yad Vashem, Dorit Novak, Excellencies, colleagues, dear survivors. First and foremost, I would like to thank Yad Vashem for hosting this event today and to take this opportunity to thank Avner Shalev for his many years of service. On November 1st, 2005, during the 42nd plenary session of the General Assembly of the United Nations, the international community made a crucial decision to commemorate collectively the most horrific man-made tragedy that ever took place in recorded human history, the Holocaust, a Shoah. Up until that day, we, the victims, the Jewish people and the people of Israel, commemorated our tragedy for six decades almost, all alone, covered with our collective grief and with the eternal question arising, why? Why did the fanatic ruler decide to annihilate an entire nation? Why and how did he become so popular in his nation and far beyond? Why was the world silent for more than 6 years while the atrocities took place? Why did God allow this to happen? And why did the millions of innocent victims not fight back enough, even when the intentions of the perpetrators became clear to all. The answers to these questions are complex and partly unexplainable. But one thing is unquestionable. Even if we cannot explain, we can never ever forget. And that is the huge significance of this International Commemoration Day, because only by remembering and commemorating year by year, we will assure ourselves and future generations that this will never repeat itself. And as we often recite in Israel, never again. My father, the late Arya Haskell, was a Holocaust 9-year-old child refugee from Austria. He never liked to speak much of his past and always preferred, like many Holocaust survivors, to live the present and discuss the future. Before he passed away, he sat with my eldest daughter and told her his entire life story, as if he knew that his days were numbered and he wanted to make sure that his story, like the one of many other thousands of children, should be carried on as a warning sign for future generations. My father recalled that one evening in 1938 in Vienna, his hometown, when he was not even 9 years old, his beloved mother packed a small case for him with a few of his belongings and toys and told him that the following morning he will be going on his own together with many other children of his age to the shores of England to seek a new destiny, a new future. At the time, Austria was already under Nazi rule and Jewish adults could not leave, including his mother. His father was already detained in a Nazi labor camp in Dachau on the outskirts of Munich in Germany. The following morning, my grandmother escorted my father to the railway station, hugged him strongly, kissed him on the forehead, and sent him off. That was the last time my father saw his mother, who was later murdered by the Nazis with their entire community. He kept on saying that if he only knew that that was the last time he would ever see his mother, he would probably have hugged her longer. My father's story is one amongst many, but as tragic and as sad as his story was, he was still among the lucky children who managed to escape the horrific fate of brutal murder and massacre. 1.5 million children were not as lucky, and we commemorate them here today. I'm extremely grateful that thanks to the International Day of Commemoration in memory of the victims of the Holocaust and events like this one today, hosted by Yad Vashem, I, like many others in Israel and around the world, can share our very personal and intimate stories with all of you. This year in particular, we witnessed these stories being told in new locations like numerous Gulf countries, Morocco, Sudan, thanks to the Abraham Accords. One thing is clear, the more we tell, less denial will prevail and humanity will improve its ways. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Haskell, for your touching and meaningful remarks. Yad Vashem's designated yearly theme for Holocaust Remembrance Observance in 2021 is entitled, Until the Very Last Jew, 80 years since the onset of mass annihilation. In June 1941, after having defeated Yugoslavia and Greece, Nazi Germany launched a surprise attack on the USSR. Operation Barbarossa was the code name given to the incursion of some 4 million troops from Germany and its allies into Soviet territory. Operation Barbarossa was a milestone in World War II and a turning point in the fate of the Jews. Jewish life that had existed for centuries in Eastern Europe was practically obliterated. Approximately 1 million Jews were murdered within the Soviet Union's pre-war borders, and some 1.5 million Jews were massacred in the territories annexed by the USSR between 1939 and 1940. The murder of the Jews of the USSR and the annexed territories was a decisive turning point towards the final solution, the systematic annihilation of the Jews by Nazi Germany. A witness to the unfolding of these devastating events was Max Privler, born in 1931 in the village of Mikulicin, then in Poland, now Ukraine. Mr. Privler lit one of the 6 torches of the state opening ceremony of Holocaust Martyrs and Heroes Remembrance Day, Yom HaShoah, at Yad Vashem in 2017.
Я родился в Западной Украине. Мой отец Давид Ривлер Гершкович был большой купец. Началась война, гестаповцы арестовывать пришли моего отца. Я схватил отца за ногу, начальник жандармерии говорит, берите этого жиденка. Нас раздели, голые шли к месту расстрела. На краю ямы отец до выстрелов взял, столкнул меня в яму. Падая сам, прикрыл меня своим телом. Когда начали кричать и подниматься раненые, эсэсовцы начали достреливать сверху яму. Под утро я начал шевелиться, увидел небо, выцарапался. Мне было ровно 11 лет. Передали, что мама опухла с голода в гетто. Пришел в гетто, вижу, гонят мою маму с братиками, с сестрой. Полицейский начал срывать у мамы мальчика, Берлика, братика, ему 1.5 года. Она резко развернулась и с такой силой толкнула этого полицейского, что он ударился об бордюр виском и на месте умер. Собрались полицейские, разорвали Берлика, а маму потащили к жандармерии и спустили веревку со 2-го этажа и повесили. У меня было только одно в голове – и убивать их, и мстить, и мстить. И вот так я мстил. Я становлюсь секретным разведчиком, и в 14 лет я становлюсь командиром группы отдельной детской разведки. Участник спасения Кракова, освобождения Освенцима. Я видел эти челюсти золотые, я видел эти волосы, я видел эти крематории, эти скелеты, которые не могли шевелиться, евреи. Мой отец, он говорит, сынок, если останешься живой, будешь рассказывать людям правду, что делали эти звери с людьми только за то, что они родились евреями. Вот это я и делаю до сих пор. Я богатый человек. У нас 6 правнуков. Внуков у нас 5. Внуки, правнуки служат, государство охраняет. Ну и я какую-то, может быть, еще пользу принесу нашей стране.
Yad Vashem is deeply committed to thorough historical study of the annals of the Shoah as the necessary factual foundation for accurate Holocaust remembrance. Sound, unrestricted historical scholarship must be at the core of Holocaust education and commemoration. I'm honored to invite Dr. David Silberklang, senior historian at Yad Vashem's International Institute for Holocaust Research, to deliver today's lecture on the subject, the paths from the mass shootings to the final solution.
Thank you very much, Yossi, for the introduction. And thank you for the organizers for sharing this story we just saw. That was quite something. The subject that I want to address, the paths, and I deliberately say it in plural, to from mass shootings to the final solution, of course, is something that I could I teach in the university over a course of a year-long seminar, but I want to share certain elements of this with you, and I'm going to show you a few things on the screen first. First of all, the title, as you see, is not just the paths from mass shootings to the final solution. I preface that with a quote from a teenager, Jewish teenager from the Vilna ghetto, who wrote in the beginning of October 1941, following or in the midst of a roundup on the Yom Kippur, the holiday of Yom Kippur, on the Jewish calendar, a roundup of Jews were being taken out to be shot outside of Vilna. He wrote what essentially was the Jewish perspective on what was happening to them, or one of the main Jewish perspectives. We are like animals surrounded by the hunter on all sides. And we'll come back to that. And I want to bear that in mind as we progress. But I want to begin the heart of the story, the heart of the talk today, with this particular story that begins on August the 1st of 1941. On August the 1st, and it actually began a couple of days before and continued a couple of days later, the murder units operating on behalf of Nazi Germany in the area of the Pripyat marshes, or today Pripyat, because it's mostly in Ukraine, an area, vast swampy area that was in Poland before the war and is today in Ukraine and straddles the border into Belarus. The units that were operating there received an order from Heinrich Himmler, and you see it here encapsulated in this quotation from one version of the order. This is being passed on from Heinrich Himmler, commander of the SS, the overall commander of the murder, to the various generals who were leading the murder, and from them to the commanders and the men in the field. All Jewish men should be executed, and the Jewish women and children pushed into the swamps. The executioners, the murderers in the field, understood this to include also who should be pushed into the swamps, the elderly and ill people in each community as well. The commanders, or at least many of them, hesitated for a moment when they got this order. Something about it caused them to pause. And they sent back a request to Himmler for clarification. Have they understood correctly? He responded to them right away, yes, you've understood correctly, carry out the orders. And they proceeded to carry out these orders all along this area of the Pripyat marshes. I mean, I'm speaking in a small country in Israel. The Pripyat marshes are an area that is several times the size of the state of Israel. Talking about a very big area. As they proceeded to round up Jews and kill them, they found that this method of murder didn't work. And as one of the murder commanders, an SS major, said, a Sturmbannführer, Franz Magiel, a commander of a cavalry unit, as he said in one of his reports on August the 12th, the driving of women and children into the marshes did not have the expected success because the marshes were not so deep that one could sink. And after a depth of about a meter, there was in most cases solid ground. That means that the floor of the swamp was not soft and they didn't sink in. And the water was not deep enough, preventing complete sinking. This raises a number of questions, this little story I just told. First of all, I could complete that story and say that when they found that drowning the Jews in the swamps was not going to work, and they had to shoot them in the swamps instead of in the way they were doing until then, lining up the Jews neatly and shooting them by firing squads. So they went back to the firing squad method and shooting them into pits that were prepared. But we have a number of questions here. First of all, what caused these commanders of the murder units to hesitate? After all, these were, we're talking about commanders who were from the SS and the German police, who were diehard Nazis, leaders of the ideology, who had already been murdering people by the thousands for weeks since the beginning of the invasion of the Soviet Union. So now they're being told to kill more people. What caused them to hesitate? And it seems that what caused them to hesitate was the nature of the killing. Who are they killing? And what does it mean, the implication of this killing? Because until that time, late July, early August, most of the murder units had been murdering all across the front from the north, Estonia, and heading into Russia towards Leningrad, and all the way to the south in southern Ukraine and so on. Most of the murder units had been killing selectively. They'd walked into each unit, each Jewish community. They'd rounded up a group of able-bodied young men and community leaders and taken them out and shot them. 50 here, a few hundred there, but they had not been shooting entire communities in most cases. And apparently the understanding was get rid of those who could lead opposition and some kind of resistance, the ones who pose a threat. And the women and the children and the elderly and the ill were not viewed as people who could pose an immediate threat. And here they're being told, turn it around. leave some of those able-bodied young men behind as forced laborers who will provide Germany with some kind of manpower for labor temporarily. And everybody else, the ones you were not killing until now, you are to kill. In other words, they were moving from selective murder by the thousands, tens of thousands, into total murder. And not only in the Pripyat marshes. When we look at the orders that went out and the communications among the murder units, what we see is that from the latter part of July through the latter part of August, all the units gradually moved over, having received the orders appropriately, they moved over to total murder. And that leads to another question. Not only what made these people hesitate, but what did they think that they were doing until then? I mean, they've been killing people by the tens of thousands. So what's the difference who they're killing? What made them hesitate here is connected to what did they think that they were involved in? Did they come into the Soviet Union planning to kill all the Jews, begin with these and then move to those? Or maybe something else was going on, which is also connected to the larger question. That is, where do we see and how did it develop that the Nazis reached a decision to murder all the Jews, everyone that they could get their hands on in that seek and destroy mission to kill all the Jews first in Europe and ultimately in all the world? These are big questions. We can't answer everything here, but I want to go back to the screen and see what we can do about that. And I want to, first of all, say a few words about the run-up to Operation Barbarossa and some of the planning. People have written books that are hundreds of pages long about this, good books and many articles. We can't go into everything. But in the run-up, it's important to point to a number of things. From the moment that Hitler gave the orders to the Wehrmacht, to the German army, to prepare Operation Barbarossa, that was in December 1940, what we see is almost immediately, when we look at the documents, almost immediately, the discourse among leading Nazi officials, whether they are uniformed in the military, the police, or the SS, or they're civilians in government service of one sort or another, the discourse became murderous, strikingly so. That what they're going into the Soviet Union to do is going to be something that is massively murderous, and the discourse is far more murderous even than the discourse when they invaded Poland in 1939, when the discourse was quite murderous and the action was quite murderous, of course. But here they're talking about something much bigger, apparently. And we know that the SS, the ideological army of the Nazi Party, and the Wehrmacht, the German armed forces, negotiated an agreement in March 1941, dividing up their jurisdiction in the territories that would be occupied. But it wasn't just a division of labor, you do this and you do that. It was also an agreement on how they were going to cooperate, and a recognition by the Wehrmacht that the SS had been given by Hitler what they called special tasks. That's one of the code words for murdering Jews. And the Wehrmacht agreed to lend logistic assistance to the SS, maps, vehicles, whatever, but also where possible to give them manpower to help carry out the murder, which they did wherever possible. We know that from the end of March 1941, in a talk that Hitler gave to the top generals of the Wehrmacht and all around all these circles I mentioned that were preparing the invasion, the talk became a discussion of a Vernichtungskrieg, a war of extermination. They were talking about exterminating the Soviet Union as an entity, as a political entity, as a country. But connected to that was discussion of how many people will need to die. And they're talking about the necessity of killing large numbers of people, especially Jews. We know that the murder units, the Einsatzgruppen, those special mobile task forces, began training in mid-May of 1941, but so too did many other kinds of units from the German police, from the SS, from the Waffen-SS. All of these began training in May of 1941, and they were prepared when Operation Barbarossa began to enter the fray and to begin murdering Jews and others who were on their agenda. And we know that on June 17th of 1941, Reinhard Heydrich one of the most important deputy commanders in the SS under Himmler, and the man who was overall in charge of all of these murder units, and later in charge of many other things in the murder of the Jews, he came to their training camp at Precz, and he gave them a pep talk. And according to the testimonies post-war of a number of the officers who were at that pep talk, Heydrich spoke explicitly about killing all the Jews, that this is what they're going out to do. But some of those people who were there and testified didn't remember exactly if he talked about killing Jews or killing the Jews. That is all or some, but clearly that was part of it. Now on the map, what you see here is the advance of the Einsatzgruppen who entered literally on the heels of the German army. When the German army invaded the Soviet Union in Operation Barbarossa, they literally entered on their heels. The first murder began the day after the invasion that began, the first massive murder. And the four Einsatzgruppen, A, B, C, D, as you see on the map, were divided, A in the north, B and C in the center, D in the south. But more units entered the fray right after that. And if you just remember this map and you see they advanced rapidly, they crossed, following the German armed forces, they crossed the pre-1939 Soviet-Polish border within a few weeks, so that they advanced so rapidly that although they were killing by the tens of thousands, they actually left many Jews alive behind because they're racing ahead to kill more and more right behind the front lines. And then later they came back, moving westward again to kill more Jews. I mean, that's how the process developed. Who were these murderers? I'm going to point out just a number of the different kinds of units to give a sense of what we're talking about. The four Einsatzgruppen we already mentioned, the specially trained mobile task forces. A fifth Einsatzgruppe was raised from among the German SS and police in the General Government of Poland, the name the Nazis gave to the part of Poland that they did not annex, but rather treated sort of like an occupied area that they were devastating, including the areas of Warsaw, Krakow, Lublin, et cetera. So another 500 men entered, and unlike the other four Einsatzgruppen that each had a kind of geographical assignment, north or center or south, this one was meant to fill in gaps and help out wherever help was needed. In addition to that, police battalions, the ORPO, Ordnungspolizei, the police battalions mechanized that had been training since May of 1941 began entering a few days after these murder units entered. By the end of August of 1941, there were 23 police battalions. By the end of 1941, there were 26 police battalions, more than 15,000 additional men out there killing Jews. In addition to that, Himmler created in May of 1941 a division out of the SS and the police, commanded by himself. He wanted to use them as a kind of special group that he could send for special missions. But their first special mission was to kill Jews along with all these other murder units. He called it Kommandostab Reichsführer SS, that he's the Reichsführer SS, so it's his division. And they participated, according to their own records, which have survived, they participated in the murder of more than 100,000 Jews by the beginning of October 1941. Other units of the Waffen-SS and the Wehrmacht and more entered the fray. So what we're looking at is massive numbers of killers from the Third Reich that entered, but they're not the only ones. In addition to them, there were all sorts of self-created units and German-created units from among the indigenous population. Not all the indigenous populations, but from among the indigenous populations, there were people who joined. First of all, those who called themselves partisans, that is pro-Nazi partisans, not like the survivor whom we saw before, an anti-Nazi partisan. They're partisans who were going to help defeat the Soviet army, shoot them in the back as they retreat if necessary, help take over the territories that Germany was entering, and they looked upon Germany as liberators. And part of what they saw as their obligation from their own nationalist perspective was to murder as many Jews as possible, whom they blamed for all sorts of terrible things, such as helping the Soviets. Among those who joined the Nazis were renegades from the Red Army, people who had been taken prisoner and switched sides. The Nazis themselves created what they called Schutzmannschaften, mobile auxiliary battalions. From among these POWs, primarily. And these mobile auxiliary battalions were primarily ethnically homogeneous, a Ukrainian unit, a Latvian unit, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. By the end of 1941, there were 33,000 local men in these units. By the end of 1942, more than a quarter million. More than a quarter million. And one of their main jobs is to help kill Jews. In addition to that, all sorts of local police from the indigenous population. The Germans didn't police every occupied country in Europe or in North Africa on their own. They relied on local police that they would oversee. But local police did the job. And here too. And the local police and militias are involved in the killing. Deeply involved. In addition to that, all sorts of well-organized ultra-nationalist movements that wanted to liberate their country. And as part of that, they saw that part of what they needed to do was to kill as many Jews as they could, such as the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, the OUN in Ukraine, or the Lithuanian Activist Front in Lithuania, or other similar kinds of groups in various places. So when we look at who's involved in the murder, it's all led and organized by Nazi Germany, but they found very many local helpers who were eagerly willing to do this. Now, I want to relate for a few minutes to six parallel tracks of development. I talked about paths to the final solution. I want to point to some of those paths. And I just outlined them here, the paths of independent allies of Germany that killed on their own, Romania and Croatia, the movement in the USSR to total murder, the development of gas vans, what happened with the Jews of the Third Reich in this same time in history, end of summer, beginning of autumn, 1941, the development of Auschwitz-Birkenau, and the role of Odilo Globocznik, we'll explain him in a few moments, and the Operation Reinhardt. First, in a photo, we know that Romania, in terms of the number of troops sent in, and Yossi referred to some 4 million troops that entered the Soviet Union, the bulk of them were German, but the second largest army by far was Romanian, which with about 500,000 troops that entered the fray. And the Romanian militias and Romanian gendarmerie and Romanian soldiers, as they progressed, retaking territories that the Soviet Union had annexed in 1940, and moving into territory that had never been Romania, crossing the border into pre-war Soviet Union in Ukraine, the Romanians murdered on their own massive numbers of Jews. The estimates vary from somewhere in the vicinity of 300,000 or just under that to somewhere in the vicinity of 400,000 or just over that. I'm not the expert on Romania to tell you who's closer to the truth, but that gives you a sense of the magnitude of the murder undertaken by the Romanian regime and their armed forces then. The scene you see here is at the beginning of that murder in the city of Iași at the end of June of 1941, where some 13, 14,000 Jews were killed within a few days. And I am showing you a photograph that is one of the least gory. I'm sparing you the goriness in this case, although the next one doesn't spare us that. We know that when we talk about moving in the Soviet Union, this is a scene from Ukraine, one of the killing pits in Ukraine, moving into total murder in the Soviet territories meant killing women and children. This is a scene inside of one of the murder pits of women who were shot. The men you see there with rifles are local people, uniformed militias, who are doing the shooting in this case, in this particular scene. The women have been stripped of their clothing. You don't waste good clothing. One of the motivations for many of the local killers is to make use of the things the Jews have, including their clothing, which we'll come back to in a moment. And here you see that the man standing and pointing his rifle in the center of the picture is aiming at a woman who's up on her elbows. That is, they're going to confirm the death. Someone survived the shooting, they'll go back and kill that person. or hear a quotation from a Polish journalist who lived on the outskirts of Vilnius, of Vilna, and kept a diary. He didn't survive the war, Kazimierz Sakowicz. And he lived right on the road from Vilnius to the murder site, Ponar or Panire. And he, we'll quote just a couple of sentences from the diary to see what he was seeing, how he understood things, how things were developing. July 23rd, it's a nice day. About 500 people are transported, executions until late. Since July the 14th, he says, the victims have been stripped to their underwear, brisk business and clothing. So one of the motivations, and here the killers are Lithuanians. He points that out over and over and over again. So here, one of the motivations of the local killers is a brisk business and clothing. August 1941, for the Germans, 300 Jews are 300 enemies of humanity. For the Lithuanians, are 300 pairs of shoes, trousers, and the like. Or he goes on September 2nd, a major murder operation in Vilna that was the beginning of putting the Jews of Vilna into a ghetto. And he's upset by what he's watching. The way they shot, the group of shooters stood on the corpses, which you saw on that picture from Ukraine as well. They walked on the bodies. The bodies were immediately covered over the next day. There were many wounded. Then he talks about those who escaped, who weren't killed and went back to Vilna. We have Jewish accounts of that also in the diary of Hermann Krupp, who met some of these women. In the testimony at the Eichmann trial of Mark Mayer Dvorzhetsky, who was a physician who treated one of these women and went to tell the community about it, what's going on. But who could believe this? And what do they do when they find a child who survived? Of course, they shoot him. Karl Jaeger, the SS colonel, who was the commander of the murder in Lithuania, wrote a summary report at the end of the job on December 1st, 1941, saying that by the end of November, they had killed more than 137,000 Jews in Lithuania, the first place where more or less the job had been completed, the first country. And to say, he says, today I can confirm that our objective to solve the Jewish problem for Lithuania has been achieved by Einsatzkommando 3, a subunit of Einsatzgruppe A. In Lithuania, there are no more Jews apart from Jewish workers and their families. And he goes on to say, and those workers, we should sterilize them. But if despite sterilization, a Jewess, a female Jew, becomes pregnant, she'll be liquidated. It's clear what's going to happen to those Jews. So this is, that's murder becoming total. But one of the questions we have to ask in understanding the paths to the final solution, if we see that Romania and Croatia also by the summer of 1941 were killing Jews in their hands on their own without German intervention. And in the Soviet Union, during the second half of the summer of 41, the murder became total murder of the Jews, as we saw in the Pripyat Marshes, as we see in Lithuania, and it continued that way. What about German planning for other places? And here I want to point to a number of things. What you're looking at is one of the gas vans, right? And we know that Walter Rauf, another SS officer, was appointed to organize the development of a gas vehicle. He wasn't the mechanic who's going to design the vehicle, but rather he was going to organize the operation to turn to various automobile companies under German control and have them design until they get the best design. They got the design completed by the end of September or beginning of October of 1941, did various test runs. And following that, the first death camp began to be constructed, Chełmno, on around November the 1st of 1941. And its method of murder was going to be this. And Chełmno is in the part of Poland that was annexed by Germany. So this is already a sign that the murder, as they're planning the gas vans, during the course of the planning for murder of Jews has now come to include at least a big part, if not all, of the Polish Jews, because they're building a death camp at Chełmno. In addition to that, we know that in Auschwitz, the planning to expand what had been a concentration camp for political prisoners, most of them Poles initially, and other kinds of prisoners, the expansion into a much larger camp to include Auschwitz II, Birkenau, and Auschwitz III, the industrial area at Monowitz, all that began in the spring of 1941. Rudolf Hess, the commandant of Auschwitz, testified after the war that he spoke with Himmler in the summer. He was summoned by Himmler, and Himmler told him to begin preparing Auschwitz for the function of becoming the main killing center for the Jews of Europe. And we see that in the fall of 1941, the Polish farmers and villagers in this 40 square kilometer area that was being taken over by the Auschwitz complex were kicked out, and then preparations began. But while that's going on, we also know that on September 3rd, 1941, the first experimental gassing was undertaken at Auschwitz. The victims were Soviet prisoners of war. The method of murder was not a gas vehicle or shooting, but Zyklon B, the pesticide that was became the method of murder at Auschwitz for the overwhelming majority of those who were killed. And we know that by October 15th of 1941, we already have from the company that went on to build gas chambers, one of the companies, a blueprint for the gas chamber and crematorium on October 15th of 1941. So there's movement there. And I mentioned Odilo Globocznik. Odilo Globocznik was the SS and police commander of the Lublin district in the general government of Poland. He ultimately became the leader, the commander of what came to be known as Operation Reinhard, which was the operation to murder all the Jews of the general government, which the Nazis estimated at more than 2 million Jews. They also killed Jews from other places, but this is where it began. And Globocznik was very close to Himmler. He also was very well organized, very creative in his evil and in his murderous capacity, and he had foresight to see where things might be going. So as the murder got underway in the Soviet Union, he made sure that he put some of his most trusted men, officers and non-commissioned officers, into that fifth Einsatzgruppe that went into the Soviet Union and had them report back to him. Tell me what's going on. And they did. And all of them that came out of Lublin under his command and had gone into the Soviet Union in the summer, all of them ended up taking up major central positions in what came to be known as Operation Reinhard. He also sent in men to do other kinds of work, and they too participated in murder of Jews. He turned to university-educated men under his command and gave them a problem. He said, if we were to want to kill Jews here, how would you do it? And they sat and they discussed and came back to him with a plan. They said, if you want to kill Jews here, what you need to do is not have the murderers chase the victims or bring the victims to the murderers. Set up some kind of killing installation, a secret camp that has to be near or on a rail line to make it easy to transport. But it must be top secret. None of this shooting and running around chasing after people, because that's much too public and that defeats the purpose. It's also difficult for the murderers. But how will you kill them? And for that, he got input from what the Nazis called the euthanasia program, codenamed T4. And one of the security commanders for Operation T4, which was suspended temporarily in mid-August 1941, Christian Wirth, an SS officer, came in the fall of 1941 to Lublin and consulted with Globocznik and gave him the idea of carbon monoxide gas. Globocznik also seized the opportunity to take POWs, Soviet POWs, out of POW camps that were not far from Lublin and offer them the opportunity to switch sides. And we know that between July of 1941 and May of 1943, around 5,000 men took that opportunity. One of them is one who most of us have heard of, right? Of course, Ivan Demjanjuk, who ended up in Sobibor. He was one of those POWs. So 5,000 in groups of a few hundred at a time going through training. In other words, he's building a private army for whatever he might want to do. Now he has people training, people with murder experience, a plan and a method of murder. And he went to Himmler in October 1941 and he got the green light from Himmler, his boss. And around November the 1st of 1941, the first of the camps of the operation he was going to command began to be constructed, Belzhets. It was completed in February 42, more complicated than Chelmno. Chelmno began operating December 8th of 41. It was easy to build because all you needed were the vehicles. Here you had to build gas chambers and places to dispose the bodies and so on, much more complicated. And then the other camps of Sobibor, Treblinka began being built later in 1942. Another parallel track. If we have different people within Germany looking to expand, let me go back before I do that, looking to expand the murder beyond the Soviet Union, whether it's Chelmno and that method of murder, or Auschwitz or Globochnik, we also have discussions inside of Germany beginning in the latter part of August of 1941 to begin deporting the Jews of the Third Reich eastward, apparently to join the fate of the Jews in the East. The East is the Soviet Union. The deportations were meant to begin in mid-September. They were postponed for various technical reasons, and they began in mid-October. The first deportations went to Poland, to the Lodz ghetto, but the subsequent deportations in 41 did indeed send thousands of Jews from the Third Reich into the Soviet Union, and many of them were killed right away in Minsk, in Riga, in Kaunas, Kovno, and so on. So we have thinking about including the Third Reich in the murder, the Jews of the Third Reich. And here, the infamous letter from Hermann Göring, the second most powerful man in Germany at that time, and the man whose functions included the overall command of all policy regarding Jews, under Hitler, of course, but he's the overall person in charge. And Heydrich, whom we've already encountered, came to him in July 41, saying, in order for me to do the things we're talking about, I need a new authorization from you. This is that authorization. I'll just look at the last sentence. I further charge you with submitting to me promptly an overall plan of the preliminary organizational, practical, and financial measures for the execution of the intended final solution of the Jewish question. July 31st, 1941. Is this a reflection of a decision on the final solution? Most historians agree, I among them, that this was not yet the decision, but rather a reflection of discussions that are underway. We're killing them all in the Soviet Union. What else can we do? And this is an authorization to carry out a feasibility study. If we do this, what does it mean? What is involved? How do we do it? What does it cost? Heydrich came back to Göring in mid-November 1941 with the results of his research. The actual document he had compiled of here's the plan or here's the feasibility study has not survived, or at least it has not yet been found in an archive. But the cover note was found. The cover note saying, following on your letter, July 31st, here's my report. But we don't know what the report said exactly. We do know that Heydrich, after that, got the green light from Hitler via Göring to convene a meeting that would discuss the final solution. We know that in December, there was a great deal of discussion among the most senior Nazis about the upcoming final solution. Here's just one illustration. Joseph Goebbels, the propaganda minister, writing in his diary on December 13, 1941, about a meeting he attended the day before of senior Nazi officials with Hitler. And he says, with respect to the Jewish question, the Führer has decided to make a clean sweep. He prophesied to the Jews that if they again brought about a world war, they would live to see their annihilation in it. That wasn't just a catchword. The world war is here. In other words, the US has entered the war. Now there's a world war. And the annihilation of the Jews must be the necessary consequence. And there are other speeches and documents from senior Nazis around the same time saying more or less the same thing. The Wannsee Conference that we all are familiar with convened in the end, not when it was scheduled originally, December 9th. It had to be postponed because of the US entering the war. It convened on January 20th, 1942, as we know. And this document that we're all familiar with was part of the background material that participants received. That is, how many Jews are there in each place? And I just want to point out two things. One is the division between Group A and Group B. Group A, places countries, territories already under German control. Group B, those territories and countries that are not yet under German control, including allies of Germany like Bulgaria, Croatia, et cetera, countries that where the war is going on, the Soviet Union, and countries that are neutral. Spain, Sweden, Switzerland, all are to be included in this final solution that they're discussing. How many Jews will be killed? More than 11 million. I want to conclude with a reflection on the Jews in all of this. From the beginning of the war, and especially from the beginning of the murder, Jews were struggling to understand what do the Nazis want and where is this going? Because if they can understand where it's going, maybe they can understand what they should try to do about it. But of course, when the murder was underway, Jews had in various places some information moving from Vilna to other places or Bialystok and other places, but it was limited information, confusing information. And by the time for the Jews in Vilna, Bialystok, or other places, by the time they got the information, most of them are dead. It's only the survivors, some of them, who get this information, and some of it is conflicting. They're working in a forced labor camp, or they're killed, or they were resettled somewhere else. They're also experiencing German deception. They're also experiencing significant numbers of their neighbors turning on them. It doesn't have to be all their neighbors turning on them to make it something that is inescapable. But there were significant numbers of their neighbors in very many places turning on them, which is where that quote is coming from that we began with, Yitzhak Rudashevsky. We are like animals surrounded by the hunter on all sides. The hunter is not only the Germans. The hunter is their neighbors, their fellow citizens of their country who know how to speak to them, know what they look like, know who the Jews are, and know where to find them. There were massive attempts by Jews at hiding and escaping. Hundreds of thousands hid or fled individually or in groups. Some of them survived. The overwhelming majority of them did not. I'd like to conclude with the story of this little place I've written on the bottom of the slide called Yanishuv. This is an illustration of what we're talking about. Yanishuv was a small forced labor camp that existed for a brief time, for several months altogether in 1942. In today's borders of Poland, it would be in southeastern Poland. And our story begins on November the 6th of 1942. There were 600 Jewish men who worked in this forced labor camp, and they worked only in day work. There was no nighttime job. November 6th, Friday night, 1942, they're in their barracks, organizing a little bit of food, whatever they have, and getting ready to go to bed. And as they're doing all this, they suddenly hear screaming outside in Yiddish, Yidden ratavit sich, Jews, save yourselves. Then they heard shooting. Then the shooting stopped, and they hear again in Yiddish, Yidden kimt erois, Jews, come out. And as these 600 Jewish men hesitatingly came out of their barracks, afraid, not knowing what happened, what did they see? A partisan unit of 18 men had stormed the camp. They were commanded by someone who had been an inmate in this camp and had fled several weeks earlier. He had meanwhile joined a partisan unit, Polish partisan unit that was actually under communist command, more or less. And the unit that came and attacked this camp, 18 men, 15 or 16 of them were Jews, and the others were Soviet POWs who had escaped the POW camp. They'd killed all the guards. As the prisoners watched, they executed the commandant in the square of the camp. And then the commander, a man named Yehoshua, turned to 600 Jews and said, you're free, you're liberated. And then he took 10 of them with him, which is the number he's allowed to take, and he went back to his partisan encampment. When he reached his partisan encampment, the commander of the unit had all of his men disarmed and had all of them, the 18 and the 10 they brought with them, shot. Apparently, he was both an anti-Semite and was afraid of competition for command. What happened to the other 600? What did they do? What did 600 liberated Jews do in November 1942? Well, apparently, according to the survivor accounts, about 440 of them escaped. and ran to the woods or people they know. But about 160 of them stayed behind, apparently because at least some of them were not even Polish Jews. They had been deported from Germany or Austria or Czech Republic, and they didn't know the language or the area. Or they were from other parts of Poland and didn't know their way around. Or maybe they were just afraid. But they couldn't just sit there. Ransacked warehouses, escaped Jews, dead Germans. So they reached a logical conclusion. They appointed a delegation of a couple of men led by a German-speaking Polish-Jewish doctor named Dr. Gross, whose job it was to go to the nearest police outpost and report what happened. And they did that. And they were told by the police, we have the German police report has survived, and we know what they said. And they were told, go back and wait until the morning and people will come and tell you what to do. And the next morning, an SS unit came together with a unit of uniformed Polish firefighters, rounded these Jews up and marched them to the nearest town, a number of kilometers away. Whoever stumbled or didn't walk fast enough, they shot. Around 50 of them were shot, just like the death marches at the end of the war. The rest of them, around 110, were put on vehicles and driven to a forced labor camp called Budzin. The commandant of Budzin was reputed among his own German colleagues to be one of the most sadistic, vicious SS men around. Some of these 110 survived that camp and subsequent camps. What happened to the 440? Well, a hunt went out after them. German police, Polish police, local people, and within a few weeks, all had been caught and killed, except one. That one was a man named Label. He had fled. Together with around 30 of his buddies from the camp, they dug some kind of large foxhole in the woods and they hid. And their arrangement was every couple of days at night, someone would go out and try to get supplies. Came his turn, he went out to get supplies. He came back under the cover of darkness and he found that all of his 30 comrades had been murdered. Not only were they murdered though, whoever killed them had stripped them naked and hacked their bodies to pieces. From that, he drew the conclusion that the people who killed them are not the Germans, it's local people. He's a hunted animal and he's alone. So what does a hunted animal alone with no chance to survive do? He reached a logical conclusion. He walked to Budzin and turned himself in. And the commandant, that sadistic, vicious SS man, let him in. And in the end, the only one who survived of all the escapees of a liberated camp was the one who turned himself in. Now, why do I tell this strange story? I tell it to point to two things. First of all, Jews who did everything they could to try to survive. But on the other hand, all the cards and the Jews' fate were held by the Germans and their collaborators. And in the development of the final solution, that too is what the Jews had to contend with in the impossible odds that they faced. Thank you.
Thank you so much, David, for that very, very important and compelling lecture. Before we conclude today's event, we would like to take this opportunity to invite you all to participate in Yad Vashem's unique online commemorative project, the I Remember Wall. Each Holocaust victim has a story, and each of us can and should be an ambassador of memory with the responsibility to serve as the voice for those who were murdered. A link to this special project is being forwarded to you all today by email. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it was our honor to host you at this virtual event. We look forward to welcoming you again soon in person and in good health on the Mount of Remembrance in Jerusalem with your colleagues, family, and friends, as together we enhance our shared commitment to meaningful and accurate Holocaust remembrance. Thank you and shalom.
and recall constantly, and we will not allow it escape from our collective memory. This is what the murdered commanded of us in their last breath, and what the survivors who are still with us today demand and expect. Everything is forbidden of us, and oh, that we do, they told themselves, in order to survive and to live proudly. It is the struggle to preserve the human spirit in the Holocaust. Elie Wiesel said that to forget the dead is the same as to killing them a second time. We must bear witness to each and every individual murdered. Only when we remember the events of the Holocaust, we will be able to prevent this tragedy of the Holocaust. We will prevent this tragedy from repeating itself. Never again. This evening will be marked by remembrance, commemoration, and the pursuit of justice. We now have the honor of hearing our President, His Excellency, the President of the State of Israel, Mr. Reuven Ruvi Rivlin.
President of the Czech Republic, Madam Speaker of the United States, House of Representatives, Nancy Pelosi, Vice President of the European Parliament, Nicola Bill, U.S. Secretary of State, Antony Blinken, Minister of Foreign Affairs, Gabi, Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Czech Republic, Thomas Petrušek, Minister of Welfare and Social Equality, Itzik Shmuli, Minister of Diaspora Affairs, Omer Yankelevich. Dear friends, the Nazi regime tried not just to murder Jews, but to wipe up the Jewish people of all face of the earth. Together with genocide, the Nazi tried to erase Jewish heritage, history, and culture. Last year, I gathered in Jerusalem more than 50 world's leaders to renew our shared promise, never again. A key element of this promise must be to preserve, restore the culture and religious heritage of European Jewish communities. Yes, we must oppose all attempts to deny or change the history of the Holocaust, but we also need to fight all attempts to deny the Nazis' campaign of cultural destruction. We must ensure that justice is done and that European Jewish communities have the means to promote the vibrant Jewish life. It also requires taking effective steps to combat anti-Semitism, such as providing physical security and adopting the IHRA definition of anti-Semitism. 76 years after the liberation of Auschwitz, this is our responsibility to the legacy of the European Jewish communities of the past and our duty to the Jewish communities of the present and the future. I want to thank my dear friend, President Zeman, Foreign Minister Petrišek, the Czech government, the European Parliament, the United States Congress and administration, and all of governments present here today for their leadership on this issue. I would also like to thank all of the organizations and research centers who have played such an important role in this effort. Thank you. So very much, as we say in Hebrew, toda rabah, and may God bless all of you.
We heard now the remarks of the President of the State of Israel, Mr. Reuven Ruvi Rivlin, as they were accorded for this occasion. It is now my honor to invite the Foreign Minister of the State of Israel, His Excellency Gabi Ashkenazi, to speak.
President of the State of Israel, His Excellency Reuven Ruvi Rivlin, President of the Czech Republic, Mr. Miloš Zeman, Secretary of the State, Antony Blinken, congratulations on your appointment. I look forward to working with you on the many important issues that we have before us. We are honored to have you. I am aware of your personal connection to the Holocaust, which you spoke so movingly about at your confirmation. Minister of Foreign Affairs, my friend, the Czech Republic, Tomáš Petříček, Madam Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, Vice President of the European Parliament, Nicola Baer, President of the Claim Conference, Gideon Taylor, Chairman of the Center of Survivor Organization, Colette Avital, Foreign Ministers, Jewish Leaders, Ambassador, distinguished guests, and most importantly, our dear Holocaust survivors who are joining us. 76 years ago, today, the largest Nazi concentration and death camp on the European soil, Auschwitz-Birkenau, was liberated. The United Nations has declared January 27th International Holocaust Remembrance Day, one of the many important achievements of the Israeli diplomacy. As a son of a Holocaust survivor, I often relive my father's stories, stories that are difficult to hear, difficult to believe, but that was the reality for him and for many millions of others. All of us must commit to ensure that these testimonies are always heard, that we will teach them to younger generation across the world. Anti-Semitism, racism, and prejudice are again rising. In some places, Jews are afraid to wear kippot. They are worried when they pray in synagogue, and Jewish students are scared to identify on campuses. The lessons of the past must be learned. We need to take effective steps now to combat them, including adopting the IRAC definition of anti-Semitism. And this must be an international effort. It is why the Terezin Declaration and the United States Just Act are so important. The need for the historical and moral justice continues. Countries must do the maximum to address and compensate for the unspeakable crimes of the Nazis and their allies during the Holocaust. I'm very grateful to my friend, Czech Foreign Minister Tomáš Petříček, for your decision to hold an international conference in 2022 based on the principle of the Terezin Declaration. It is another important step in the process of memory and justice. The Nazi regime wanted to wipe the Jewish people from the face of the earth. Today, Iran and its proxies call for the destruction of the Jewish people living in Israel. This call cannot be ignored. They have the power to become mass extermination, and it is our responsibility to ensure that this can never happen again. Today, the Jewish people are no longer powerless, and Israel will always defend itself by itself. Despite the negative trends, this last year also saw signs of hope and change. We can see a new era, an era of mutual discussion, an era of peace, hope. I continue to believe that there can be a better future for this region. In last October, I visited Germany with my friend, the UAE Foreign Minister, Sheikh Abdallah bin Zayed Al Nahyan. At his initiative, we visited together the Holocaust Memorial in Berlin. In a moment of history, I shared my family's history with him and with my friend Heiko Maas, the German foreign minister. Our joint visit sent a message to the whole world, a message of recognition of the history of the Jewish people, their legacy, and a message of unity, solidarity, and hope. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to finish by addressing the survivors. You represent the victory of good over evil, a hope over despair, the very best of humanity. We will continue to study the past. We will continue to learn lessons for the future. But we also live in the present, and I promise we will continue to care for you, for your families, and for your communities. This is our promise, to remember, to protect, and not to forget, to join the voices of the victim, and to swear, never again.
Thank you very much. It is our honor to now hear from the President of the Czech Republic, His Excellency Miloš Zeman.
I think that the main matter is the simple anger. According to the more successful nations or more successful countries. And that's why this regime is still present, is present in the complex. As for Jewish people, as for Israel. It is present in the cowardness, which is sometimes called as an appeasement. We see it in the European Union, which is strictly pro-Palestinian, that is pro-terrorists, and we see it in Iran, who speaks about extinction of Israel from the map. What is else than the new form of Holocaust, extinction from the map? So, friends, in my last speech in Knesset, I said, betraying Israel, we betray ourselves. Please, in the name of suppression of any new form of Holocaust, please do not betray ourselves.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you very much. We will now hear from His Excellency, Minister of Labor, Welfare and Social Services, and acting as Minister for Social Equality, Itzik Shmuli.
Excellences, dignitaries, and distinguished guests. It is really humbling for me to speak with you on days so important to the Jewish people. There isn't a single Jew without a connection to the Holocaust. It is a thread of disappear and sadness that bind us together across borders and oceans. This year, we mark the 76th year since the liberation of the Nazi concentration camp Auschwitz and the closing of the darkest chapter of our people's history. Despite the hardship around the world from the coronavirus pandemic, we still gather to fulfill our obligation to remember the atrocities of the past and renew our commitment to the future that they should never happen again. In Israel, we have the Garden of the Righteous among the nations, nestled by Yad Vashem, that honors nations and non-Jews who put their safety at stake so that their fellow men and women could escape the clutches of the Nazi regime. I wish to thank you, our honorable guest, join us today in commemorating the International Holocaust Memorial Day and to continuing the efforts started by those righteous individuals. From taking a stand against anti-Semitism to the activities undertaken by your governments, we stand together in our fight for this most important cause. When examining the depravity of the Holocaust, it is not only the magnitude of the genocide our people experience that is horrifying, but as the president mentioned before, it's the systematic nature of the persecution itself, the targeting of Jews, and the attempt to erase them, erase the culture, erase their existence, erase their history, and rob them of their future. Elie Wiesel astutely noted that we must always take sides. Neutrality helps the oppressor, never the victim. Silence encourages the tormentor, never the tormented. Dear survivors, today we stand together with you, affirming our commitment to never being silent. And in tribute to the hardship you suffered and horrors you witnessed. Our gathering here today in Jerusalem, the capital of the Jewish state, is a symbol of your personal victory over the Nazi perpetrators. And out of the ashes of the Holocaust, we have risen. We don't stand in the shadow of the Holocaust, but instead are guided by the light of 6 million blessed souls who perished and by the wisdom of those we are still fortunate to have with us. In Israel, we fulfill the Zionist vision to rebuild in our ancient homeland, guarded by the strong men and women of the Israel Defense Forces who carry out their mission to ensure that never again shall our people be at mercy of others. It is our moral imperative to work together in order to ensure that every survivor receives the recognition, support, and care they need to live their life with dignity and in good health. As Minister of Labor, Welfare, and Social Services, and Minister for Social Equality, it is my privilege to lead the government's efforts to do just that. In Israel, no survivor should worry about where their next meal will come from, if they will be able to receive the health care they require, or if the government will tend to their most critical needs. Under my watch, that will not change. At the same time, the past few years have proven that while time moves on and distances us from the period of Shoah, the scourge of anti-Semitism still finds a home in the hearts of many across the world. These instances are a stark reminder that it is not only our duty, but our moral obligation to root out and confront any form of anti-Semitism or racism where it rises its ugly head. Similarly, and especially during this period, it is essential that survivors receive a renewed commitment from governments and organizations around the world for their well-being. We look today to our partners in the international community, like-minded states and international organizations, in the hope to continue to work together for the benefit of Holocaust survivors. And I want to thank you all for being here today. To the Holocaust survivors and their families here with us, in the name of the Israeli government, I wish to reaffirm our commitment to you and assure you that together with our partners, we will take all the necessary steps to assist and support you. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Shmuli. Yulia Rovinsky and Marcel Bergman, members of the Israeli Philharmonic Orchestra, will now play Kaddish by Ravel. Thank you. Thank you. We'll now hear remarks from the Foreign Minister of the Czech Republic, Tomáš Petříček, His Excellency.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, I would like to welcome you to the first virtual commemoration of the Holocaust, broadcast simultaneously from Jerusalem and Terezin concentration camp. This connection symbolizes our joint efforts to commemorate the victims of the Holocaust and not to allow such horrors in our days and in the future. Today, we remember 6 million innocent children, women and men of Jewish origin who were killed due to an unprecedented brutality by the Nazi regime. We solemnly mourn all people who were tortured or killed at Auschwitz, Majdanek, Mauthausen, Terezin, Treblinka, and all other concentration camps around Europe. It is our duty to continue learning and remembering those whose fate should never be forgotten. Czech diplomacy will continue to support programs with new educational methods attractive for young people. Today, we also reaffirm Czech Republic's long-term position to combat anti-Semitism. We aim at judiciary reforms and efficient prosecution of criminal acts of hatred, xenophobia, and anti-Semitism, with a special focus on the internet. Crimes committed online should be punished just as crimes committed offline. To point out the continuing significance of the Terezin Declaration endorsed by 47 countries during the Czech EU presidency in 2009, I'm pleased to announce that the Czech Republic will be hosting a high-level conference of signatory states during the Czech presidency in 2022. The conference will focus on education, justice, and restitution of looted property during the Holocaust. Our goal is to strive for justice and to build a better and safer world for future generations, a world without hatred, xenophobia, and genocide. Thank you.
Thank you, His Excellency Tomáš Petříček. We will now hear from Speaker of the House of Representatives of the United States, the Honorable Nancy Pelosi.
Hello. As Speaker of the House, it is an honor to join world leaders to mark International Holocaust Remembrance Day on behalf of the United States Congress. It is a special privilege to do so with Israeli President Reuven Rivlin. A thank you to Ministers Gabi Ashkenazi and Ishak Shmuli for organizing this important commemoration. Today, the international community pauses to honor the 6 million Jews murdered and countless others silenced forever because of who they were and what they believed. The unfathomable horrors of the Shoah challenge us all to rededicate ourselves to our sacred duty, never again. 1 year ago this month, I had the solemn honor to lead a bipartisan delegation to Poland and Israel to commemorate 75 years since the liberation of Auschwitz-Birkenau. In that hallowed place, we reaffirmed America's enduring commitment to remember the names and stories of all who suffered and to ensure that such horror should never take place again. The honor of addressing you today is made even more meaningful when I recall the words of my father, then Congressman Thomas D'Alessandro Jr. of Maryland. In March 1943, as a member of Congress and a member of the Committee for a Jewish Army of Stateless and Palestinian Jews, he rose on the floor of the House calling for action, not pity, to address the plight of European Jews, stating, "Too much has been said, too little done." In his words, "Daily, hourly, the greatest crime of all time is being committed. A defenseless and innocent people is being slaughtered in wholesale massacre of millions." Shamefully, around the world, we continue to see the forces of anti-Semitism, hatred, and intolerance raising their voices. But in the face of rising hate, words are not enough. As my father said, action, not pity. That is why last year, America passed and enacted the Never Again Education Act to help educate our country about what can happen when hate goes unchallenged and oppression is met with indifference. And 3 years ago, we enacted the Justice for Uncompensated Survivors Today Act to support the 2009 Terezin declaration to ensure justice and restitution for victims and families of the Nazis' theft. The JUST Act mandated the State Department's report produced last year on our country's ongoing efforts with our European counterparts to fulfill the promise of Terezin in a vital resource to ensure that real action is taken to remember, perpetuate, and pursue justice. And today we welcome news that Luxembourg has reached an historic agreement with its Jewish community and the WJRO, keeping its commitment to dedicate resources for restitution as well as important memorialization, research, and education initiatives. The lessons of the Holocaust remind us all that we cannot and will not stay silent in the face of bigotry and injustice. America is proud to solemnly pledge to never back down from the critical work of building the future of peace, hope, and dignity for all. On behalf of the United States Congress, thank you for your tireless leadership and partnership in this vital mission. Thank you.
Thank you. We are honored to hear now His Excellency Anthony Blinken, Secretary of State of the United States, in what I think is one of his first statements after being confirmed as Secretary of State.
Today is my first day as U.S. Secretary of State, and recording this message is one of the first things I'm doing, because Holocaust Remembrance Day matters a great deal. It matters to me personally, as the stepson of a Holocaust survivor. My stepfather was just a boy when he lost his entire family to the Nazis. He spent nearly 4 years in labor and death camps before he managed to escape and was later rescued by American troops. The story made a deep impression on me. It taught me that evil on a grand scale can and does happen in our world, and that we have a responsibility to do everything we can to stop it. Those lessons are as vital now as they've ever been. Maybe more so. It's no accident that people who seek to create instability and undermine democracy often try to cast doubt on the Holocaust. They want to blur the line between truth and lies. They want to use disinformation and conspiracy theories to gain power. And they want to provoke hate against Jewish people and more broadly against refugees and asylum seekers, people of color, LGBTQ people, anyone who has been targeted for violence and dehumanized because of who they are. That's why it's so important that we speak the truth about the past, to protect the facts when others try to distort or trivialize Holocaust crimes, and to seek justice for the survivors and their families. Every day that I serve as Secretary of State, I will carry the memory of my stepfather and his family and the 6 million Jewish people and millions of others who were killed during the Holocaust. I'll remember that a nation's power isn't measured only by the size of its military and economy, but by the moral choices it makes. And I will remember that atrocities like the Holocaust don't just happen. They're allowed to happen. It's up to us to stop them. Never again. Thank you.
Thank you, His Excellency Anthony Blinken. We now cross to Brussels in Belgium. It is our honor to hear from the Honorable Vice President of the European Parliament and Chair of the Working Group Against Antisemitism, Member of the European Parliament, Nicolas Béor.
Last year on this day, I was standing in front of the Gate of Death in Auschwitz-Birkenau camp on the occasion of the 75th anniversary of its liberation. Every time I visit places of commemoration like this, Yad Vashem or others, I'm again deeply touched by what I see and feel. I will never be able to grasp the atrocities that have been committed by my people. This year, due to the pandemic, I could not visit a place of commemoration. But even if I cannot be with you today, be assured that my memories are still alive. My prayers and my heart go out with you. I'm conveying my deepest condolences to the victims and their families. I'm sharing your grief. I humbly bow my head and show my respect to all survivors and their families. The International Holocaust Memorial Day is also your day, a day I want to applaud you and reassure you, you are not forgotten. more or less 400,000 Jewish, and not to forget the non-Jewish victims, are still alive. These remaining survivors, mainly women, often live in difficult social conditions, often under the poverty line. They are facing loneliness because their families have been murdered, or they suffer from the inability to have children due to the cruel experiments they underwent in the Nazi camps. Therefore, I want to put the role and issue of Shoah survivors back into the center of attention. Directly interconnected is the issue of immovable property, Jewish cemeteries, and bloated art. The Terrorism Declaration 2009 was a great promise to rectify the consequences of the wrongdoing, but it doesn't mean that we can go on and twiddle our thumbs. We need new ways to better support the victims of yesterday so that they will not become the victims of today, because this is about justice. We, as a value-based European Union, need to ensure that all survivors live in dignity and their confiscated property has been completely recovered or compensated. I am filled with concern when I am thinking of the fact that soon more lieux de mémoire will fade away and the remaining Holocaust survivors will not be able anymore to share their stories. Therefore, one of my next projects with the European Parliament Working Group Against Antisemitism will be a dialogue with Holocaust survivors organizations. I want to intensify work on the triangle education, commemoration and social media to find a more appropriate way to reach out to the younger generation. In my mind, I have pilot projects that already take place in Germany, where pupils receive a vocational training as a witness from a Holocaust survivor. They record their stories and then convey their message while speaking to classes and at public events. Another project that deals as a role model for intensified work with the digital sphere is the project of Eva Stories, a fictional diary on Instagram of a girl murdered in Auschwitz to make history more tangible for the youth. Speaking of social media, I need to recall by repeated warning of the European Parliament's resolutions on the rise of antisemitism and Holocaust denial. Let me be clear. Every antisemitic rise puts European values like respect for democracy, human rights, the rule of law, and the stability of our society in danger. The COVID-19 pandemic helped spreading and manifesting anti-Semitic online hatred. People become even more exposed to hate speech and disinformation than ever. Terrorist organizations like Hezbollah or the BDS movement are fishing for new members with their propaganda in the internet. This is why we need to start early and with a multifaceted approach. We need to look into schools and universities and their curricula, and at the training of public servants. Here, the definition of anti-Semitism of the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance is the right tool of prevention. It also needs to be included in the revision of the EU digital rules applicable to digital platforms, especially as it regards the illegality of Holocaust denial. We have to talk more and cooperate better with member states and platforms like Facebook, Google, and so on. Finally, in all this sadness and grief of remembrance, after all the work we still have to do on prevention, I want to give a positive outlook. Last year, the German Council Presidency truly focused on implementing the IRA definition at the level of the member states. The 44th interparliamentary meeting between the European Parliament and the Knesset anchored the IRA definition as a legal and educational instrument in its declaration, and finally, as a milestone, the Council published its declaration on the fight against antisemitism as a cross-cutting issue on all levels of government. May this be the right foundation for awareness and determination of our younger generation, shouting in the face of intolerance and populism, never again.
Thank you. We now return to Julia Rovinsky and Marcel Bergmann to hear the Schindler's List
by John Williams. The Schindler's List by John Williams. We will now hear from Her Excellency Omer Yankelevich, the Israeli Minister for Diaspora Affairs.
Thank you very much, Toda Rabba. Minister of Foreign Affairs, Mr. Gabi Ashkenazi. Minister of Welfare, Mr. Itzik Shmuli, Jewish community leaders, Holocaust survivors and their families, distinguished guests, it is an honor to be with you today. International Holocaust Remembrance Day is a day for the global community to come together to remember and mourn the millions of innocent Jews and others who were murdered by the Nazis. But today is not only a day of reflection, it is also a day to take responsibility. With fewer and fewer Holocaust survivors among us, we must do everything within our power, particularly now, to ensure their health and well-being. Despite various challenges and restrictions, the Israeli government is examining how to quickly vaccinate Holocaust survivors on a global level. The government of Israel, the Prime Minister, is dedicated to this effort and exploring how to overcome the challenges and make this a reality. I turn to you to join this mission through prioritizing the speedy vaccination of the survivors in your respective countries. With our united efforts, we can ensure that by Passover, the holiday of freedom, Holocaust survivors worldwide can be free of this danger and its misery. 80 years ago, these survivors suffered from the silence of the world. Now they deserve our full attention. Today is a reminder of the consequences of inaction. Despite the Western world's global call, never again, anti-Semitism is on rise. This week, the Ministry of Diaspora Affairs released its annual anti-Semitism report, while it notes a welcome growth in the countries and organizations committed to fighting anti-Semitism. It also highlights how COVID-19 intensified this ancient plague. Various conspiracy theories blaming and linking Jews to the pandemic are spread widely on social media. Unfortunately, we know that this online hatred translates to the street, threatening the safety of Jewish communities. We must together demand that social media companies take full responsibility for what is shared on their platforms. Anti-Semitism is a global illness. Therefore, it requires a global response. Let us all come together, eradicate it from our shared world. This is our ethical obligation for our survivors, our communities, and our future. Thank you. Toda rabba.
Thank you. The Claims Conference is a global organization dedicated to the welfare of Holocaust survivors wherever they may be. Dozens of Jewish organizations are members of this conference. We will now cross to New York, where the president of the Claims Conference, Mr. Gideon Taylor, will speak.
Thank you, distinguished ministers, honored guests, Holocaust survivors. On behalf of the Claims Conference and the World Jewish Restitution Organization, I am deeply honored to be with you today, and I thank the Government of Israel for hosting this truly meaningful gathering. I often look back at old letters that my grandfather received from his relatives in Eastern Poland during the war. The last letter that he received is from his sister. It says, "Dear brother, we received your card today, and we were very happy to hear from you. About us, what can I tell you? And so many others, not long after that letter was written, those voices were silenced, never to be heard again. Today, we remember the 6 million Jews who were systematically slaughtered during the Shoah and the methodical theft of their every possession that was an integral part of the genocide. We do so at a time when Holocaust denial and distortion and other forms of anti-Semitism are on the rise, and when awareness of the Holocaust is decreasing. Recent studies by the Claims Conference found that in many countries, almost half of young people could not name a single camp or ghetto, not even Auschwitz, liberated 76 years ago today. As the generation of Shoah survivors gets smaller with each passing day, the urgency of education, remembrance, and commemoration grows ever greater. We need to think deeply about how we will educate future generations in new and creative ways. As we join together today, we pledge to the victims that they will never be forgotten and that their legacy will be kept alive. And we pledge to you, the survivors, that we will never teaching and learning about what you endured and survived. Let us also remember our urgent duty to care for remaining survivors. Today, there are still survivors around the world who need our help. We must meet this sacred responsibility at a time when survivors are confronting the perils of a global pandemic. Survivors have faced this challenge with bravery and with fortitude. Let us honor the heroism of people of goodwill around the world who have done so much to care for Holocaust survivors safely and to help survivors combat social isolation in this difficult and lonely time. Today's virtual program began in Jerusalem, home to most Holocaust survivors in the world. And it concludes in Terezin, where 47 countries gathered in 2009 to endorse the Terezin Declaration. Let us take a moment to celebrate the important steps that so many countries have taken to promote Holocaust education and remembrance. This very day, we concluded an important agreement with Luxembourg. Let this year's International Holocaust Remembrance Day serve as a bold call to action for countries and for us all to act urgently, to uphold the commitments made in Terezin, to provide for the welfare of Holocaust survivors, preserve the memory of those who perished, secure justice for survivors and their family, and to teach the lessons of the Holocaust to the generations of today and of tomorrow. Thank you.
I thank you for your remarks, Mr. Taylor. We now have the honor of hearing from the chairwoman of the Center Organizations of Holocaust Survivors in Israel, a former ambassador, member of the Israeli Knesset, and Holocaust survivor herself, Ms. Colette Avital.
Honored presidents, ministers, dignitaries, representatives of the 47 countries who signed the Terezin Declaration, and dear Holocaust survivors. To be a Jew is to remember. This is what Elie Wiesel, who devoted his whole life to be the voice of the 6 million, used to say. Today, as we mark the 76th anniversary of the liberation of the Auschwitz-Birkenau camp, I'm honored to bring to you the voice of the survivors, those men and women and children who returned from the hell of the camps, the torture, dehumanization, starvation and disease, more broken than alive. Those men and women who came out of the ashes and with courage and with determination, they rebuilt their lives, they raised new families and continued and contributed to the countries of their choice in every field of life, science, technology, medicine, the arts, the economy. Today, these men and women, survivors, who live among all of us, in Israel, which is their home, in the Czech Republic, in Russia, or in the United States, are reaching the last stages of their lives. On this International Remembrance Day, it is them too that we should remember. It is to them, to their courage, to their contributions to mankind that we must also pay tribute, and to their well-being that we must devote our efforts. For us, survivors of the Holocaust, the International Remembrance Day represents the recognition of the world of that unspeakable, unprecedented crime in the history and the resolve to learn from the past. For us, survivors, it was not only the will to survive that motivated and motivates us today, but also the will to tell the story. For us, memory is sacred. It is part of our tradition and of our identity as a people. But as the age of the Holocaust survivor is drawing to a close, before long there will be no one to say, "I was there, I remember, I know what happened there." We ask ourselves, and we ask all of you, how will the Holocaust be remembered 50 years from now? Will it be just a page in history books, which some will choose to learn and others probably to ignore? Will it be relinquished to literature or to research? And this question becomes more pressing, more daunting, as we witness the upsurge and the growth of anti-Semitism and hate crimes in various corners of the world, the attacks of Jews in schools, supermarkets, and the shrines of prayer, just because they are Jews. We, who thought after World War II and the Holocaust that anti-Semitism is a thing of the past and that the lessons have been learned, we see with broken hearts hatred, ignorance, and the denial of the Holocaust around us. So for us, the resolution of the United Nations to mark this special day in every country is of extreme importance. It is a necessity. Today is a day to reflect and to remember. It is a day to try to understand what made genocide, that decision to wipe a whole people from the face of the earth possible, the hatred, the racism, indoctrination of the masses. This day is dedicated to strengthen our resolve to fight against anti-Semitism and prejudice, the incitement and the racism that have become so prevalent again. In the Jewish tradition, the command to remember is absolute, but its obligation does not end with the cognitive of memory. It must be connected both to meaning and to action. The fundamental lesson of Judaism is that memory must be accompanied by action of moral intent. Moral intent is the obligation to fight against genocide and racism anywhere in the world. And yes, moral intent also means that those who have survived hell, the hell of the Holocaust, now in their late 80s and 90s, are entitled to a measure of justice before it is too late. Justice that would help them continue to live in dignity until the end of their lives. The Holocaust, which established the standard for absolute evil, is not only the tragedy of the Jews. It is, and it should be, the universal heritage of civilized people. The lessons of the Holocaust must form in every one of our countries the cultural code for education towards humane values, democracy, human rights, tolerance, and opposition to racism and totalitarian regimes. 76 years ago, the rescuers, whom we call the righteous among the nations, taught us that even in the hell known as the Holocaust, the individual had and still has the choice and the capacity to behave humanely. This is the lesson that we must also teach. So today, we pledge to the 6 million that they will not be forgotten and that their legacy will be kept alive. And we pledge to continue our struggle for justice so that we can create a better world for the generations to come. And I thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Colette Avital. In the compound of the Theresien concentration camp, known also as Theresienstadt, are the Czech Republic's special envoy for Holocaust issues, Dr. Robert Rehak, Holocaust survivor, Ms. Dita Kraus, and the Israel's ambassador to the Czech Republic, Mr. Daniel Miron. As is known, only 19,000 of 140,000 Jews survived this concentration camp. We will now cross to Theresien.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, there is a mysterious bond, zvláštní pouto, Hakešer Hanistar, between the Czech and Jewish nations over the centuries. One of the examples of this bond is that we organize this live broadcast from Jerusalem and Theresien today to commemorate the victims of Holocaust. Despite the current difficult situation in our both countries and around the globe, you can now be with us in Theresien. Theresien became an integral part of Nazi terrible plan of the final solution of the Jewish question, and originally small civil town and its military fortresses
were converted into a ghetto. Gradually, from 1941, there were more than 140,000 prisoners, men, women, and children deported here. They were concentrated here until the extermination camps in the East were ready to carry out their final liquidation. But many thousands died also here as a result of stress, hunger, and bad hygienic conditions. From October 1942, almost all went to Auschwitz. The fate of children of Terezin was equally tragic. From 7,590 youngest prisoners deported from Terezin, only 142 survived. One of them was Dita Kraus. Dita Kraus was born in 1929 in Prague. She was deported to Ghetto Terezin when she was 13 years old. She is one of a few surviving children whose drawings have been saved by a miracle. Later, she was deported to Auschwitz and Bergen-Belsen. Dita's father and mother didn't survive. After the war, Dita emigrated to Israel, and now she lives partly in Israel and in the Czech Republic. She has four grandchildren and four great-grandchildren. Part of her life story was adopted into the book The Librarian of Auschwitz. Despite the horrors of the concentration camps, Dita is for me a great example of positive approach to live. 2 days ago, I brought her from hospital where she was able to overcome even the coronavirus.
Today, I've been chosen to represent what my husband used to call graduates of Auschwitz. We are all a link in a chain. Each of us is one little bit of a stream. But the stream of life of generations of our ancestry was severed tragically during the Holocaust, and many of those never recovered. Many of those chains are lost forever. In my case, I feel privileged that I was able to contribute to recreate or to reconnect to the link and continue the flow of life of our family. My husband and I established a new family which goes on, and I hope will never be destroyed again.
Right now, we are in Magdeburg barracks, which played an important role in the ghetto. The barracks served as the offices and accommodation, but they were also known as a venue of major cultural events like the famous children opera Brundibar, religious services, or academic lectures. Terezin ghetto is a testimony to the spiritual resistance to the evil and Nazis' atrocities. The fascinating story of this unique chapter in European culture history is also a message to our difficult present days. Please let me read the words of one of Terezin's young inhabitants. It is a part of a poem written in the ghetto in the spring of 1943 by an anonymous little child. A place of evil and fear, there's little to eat and much to want. Where bit by bit, it's horror to live. But no one must give up. The world turns and times change. We would now like to honor the memory of the victims of the Holocaust by lighting 6 candles, symbolizing those 6 million innocent men, women, and children. And I would like to ask His Excellency, Ambassador of Israel in the Czech Republic, Daniel Meron, to light the first candle.
I light the candle in memory of family members, Bedřich and Max Lindenbaum from Bruntal, Moravia, who were sent to this camp, to Terezin, and from here to their death in Auschwitz and Dachau, and also in memory of 1 million of the victims.
The second candle will be lit by President of Federation of Jewish Communities in the Czech Republic, Peter Papoušek.
I lit this candle for Arnoš Beckman, my grand-grandfather, who perished in Auschwitz and went through Theresienstadt, and in the memory of another 1 million victims.
The third candle will be lit by Director of Terezin Memorial, Jan Roubínek.
I would like to light a candle to commemorate name of Bedřich Polák, merchant from Luže, who was murdered in concentration camp Buchenwald in March 1945. This way, I would like also commemorate names of 1 million others.
אני מדליק נר זיכרון לזכר בן משפחה מקס מנשה קארטמן מברטיסלבה שנרצח בברגן בלזן ולזכר עוד מיליון מהקורבנות שנרצחו בשואה.
Já zapaluji svíčku na památku Petra Ginze, který jako chlapec byl v Terezíně, vedl časopis Vedem a zemřel, když mu bylo 16 let, v Auschwitzu. The last candle will be lit in memory of young athlete Freddy Hirsch, who as sports teacher helped other young people, at least for a while, to forget the horrors that were around them and create hope for a better future, and in a memory of 1 million other victims.
Thank you, Special Envoy Rehak, for your outstanding and highly appreciated contribution to this event. We would like to thank the American Special Envoy Sherry Daniels for the tremendous ongoing support, and we thank the Israeli Special Envoy Ambassador Dan HaEzrachi for organizing this conference together with Dr. Avi Weber and Mrs. Noah Blecher-Orenstein. With that, we conclude our ceremony commemorating International Holocaust Remembrance Day, broadcasted to you from the Israeli Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Jerusalem. Shoah, never again. We wish you peace and health from Jerusalem.